Hey, Sniper Side here, bringing you a very special interview we did with Dave Walls of Accuracy International. Dave was recently in the U.S. for the 50 Cal Nationals, and we had a chance to sit down and talk with Dave and Addie Newberry of the Accuracy International shooting teams. We've got some behind-the-scenes details on the origin of the Accuracy International rifle system. Dave was the inventor, and we'll just let him talk to you in his own words. But I hope you enjoy this video, and don't forget to go down below and subscribe if you want to see more of this kind of content. Thanks for watching. Recite the story of starting the Accuracy International, building the rifle, the action, and how you went about from the beginning where this started. What is it, 39 years now? For
it's around about 39 years
so
ago.
So we'll round it and call it 40.
Yeah.
In that way. But tell everybody how the action, the design, and how you just came about.
You didn't want me to start before that?
Start in your history shooting, because you were competition shooting.
I was a competition shooter, yeah. Yeah, I was basically doing three position shooting, air rifle, mm-hmm. Both full bore and small bore, and air rifle. Found myself quite successful at it, got in the national team, and I met a guy named Malcolm Cooper, who actually became twice Olympic gold medalist and also world record holder. I met him at a barbecue after, basically, I met him at a three-position shoot, but then afterwards at a barbecue, I was introduced to him personally by a guy named Pete Thompson, who was also in my rifle club. And he suggested that I showed Malcolm a couple of Colt pistols I'd made. I made a Colt 44 Army, and I'd made a Colt 45 Peacemaker. I did this basically from sketches and measuring things.
You saw John Wayne on TV and said, I'm going to make one of them.
I've always been a bit of a cowboy at heart. I've always liked Colts.
Yeah.
So a colleague of mine who I work with, a guy named Dave Kaye, he was interested in shooting as well. So we got together and decided we'd make a couple of these pistols. So what we did, we looked at photographs and things. Then we went to a gun auction and managed to sort of lay coins and things next to guns and take pictures of them so we could scale the guns. But from that, we did drawings, went to work in our day jobs and made these parts, basically at dinner times and on late shifts and things like this, and we built these Colts. We showed them to Malcolm Cooper, and he said, you've got the potential to design your own weapon. And I said, well, I already have. So he came back to my house where I had a little workshop up the end of my garage. I've called it my shed. And he had a look at these weapons and saw what we'd done regarding, you know, a rifle action, and said he wanted one. So we built him one. And next thing, he went and shot a world record with the thing. I think we were about as thrilled as he was. He'd got a world record, and we had made a world record beating rifle. So, you know, it basically took off from that, because Malcolm had lots of military had lots of military contacts, and he was approached by one of them about a new sniper rifle for the British infantry. And I thought he was going off his head, because here I was with a little workshop that if I was lucky I could only make one action in, say, about 6 weeks. I only had model making machinery. It wasn't as if I had a big machine shop. And, you know, we're now looking at a military contract. And anyway, Malcolm turned around and said, well, look, we can make it. We'll probably never win it, but it will be a good test for the weapon. And if we get a weapon tested, and, you know, it probably fail, we get thrown out.
What was the sniper rifle before the 96? Was it a...
We called it the Green Meanie.
The Green Meanie?
Yeah, that was actually supplied to...
Before you built it, what were they using, an Enfield variant still?
They was using an L-42 It was a Parker Hull.
Parker Hull rifle. Gotcha.
L-42. Which you could see the faults with a Parker Hull, because the way the ejector port was at the top and the magazine port was in the underneath, all it had was two side rails, and the scope was fitted to the front part of the action and the rear part, and every time you fired the thing, the action would flex, mm-hmm. and the scope would move. So it lost its accuracy straight away. So I knew I had to make a rifle that the barrel and action was one straight piece that was not going to flex in any way, and the sight rail had to fit on it and be rigid. I couldn't have like a sight rail that spanned an ejector port. It had to be bolted straight along the top or part of the action. So we made this up. The first 42 rifles went to the special forces, the SAS and the SBS. One of them had 8 and the other one had, was it 34, I think it was. I'm not sure which way round it was now, you know, who had the 34 and who had the 8, I can't remember, but they were very satisfied with them. We got a lot of feedback from them. Then when it came to doing the L96 contract, or the trial for the L96 contract, we supplied the trial rifle, and we had feedback from the special forces, from the weapons they were using, which gave us good insight in what changes we needed to make. There was 17 gun companies in all submitted their weapons. After about 2 months, we were down to about 8 that were left. Another month passed and we were down to about 5, and I was beginning to get concerned, because I thought, if we win this, we're going to look pretty stupid, because you know, there was me with my Boxford lathe and my my old Victoria mill and a very, very old Warco surface grinder, and that was about the only machinery I had.
In your garage?
In my garage, yeah. Or my shed, as I called it, yeah. So we're going to get a bit concerned. Carried on, and we were down to 3 left. There was BSA, Parker Hale and us. Then BSA unfortunately had a bit of a breakage, so BSA went out of the trial. So
that's the motorcycle people, right?
Yeah, well, they made, but that was another branch of the company.
Yep.
Yeah. They went out. I was a little bit inwardly upset, because they were a good British company and they make a very good weapon, or they made a very good weapon, and they went out, basically went out of business. They went into receivership within a week of losing their trial. I didn't like to see that, but you know, too late, couldn't do anything about it, it's gone, you know. Then it came to the final test between Parker Hale and us, and basically they chose us, because Parker Hale, their weapon had been all changes and a, you know, advances in development with that rifle had been done. There was nowhere for it to go from where it was, so we were there, brand new kids on the block, and we had to admit to where we were in this. Well, the MOD were fairly lenient about it, because they turned around and said they didn't mind, providing they could have some input in the company that actually did the manufacturing.
Yeah,
so
makes sense.
Yeah, so it was manufactured at a company in Dartford that actually made missiles, and I had to go to Dartford and live up there for about 6 months while the start of the contract was actually manufactured, just to oversee it. That was a little bit different for me, because, you know, I was a young guy then. I was only basically either just about 30 or in my very late 20s. And I was going to this company that made rockets. And the people looked at me and as if to say, you know, we make rockets. You know, what do you know? You know, and it was very much like that. And after a while, I managed to... It didn't take very long for me to convince them I did know what I was talking about, and then they began to listen after they'd made a few pretty serious mistakes. They did the first half of the contract, then we decided we would take it on from there, because we'd been paid a lot of the revenue, because it was a £1.2 million contract. This was back the start of the 80s, 1.2 million was an awful lot of money. You know,
Nothing today.
You know, you get almost get a credit card with that much on it today, can't you? You know, but back then it was an awful lot of money. So we set up shop and got a couple of CNC machines, and I did a bit of a crash course on programming CNC machines. And my son started working with me, and he was doing an apprenticeship where he was learning to use and program CNC. So between us, we got our heads together and knuckled down and found a way of programming these things. I did have one little problem where I was trying to do a repeat, like when I had a fixture made to do six components at once, I got it to do one component, and when it came to moving on to the next one, it did the next one but didn't want to move on any further, and I couldn't understand why, and I spent ages trying to sort this out. And the reason was I had to put incremental in instead of just a datum shift. It had to be an incremental datum shift to make it move on, and I didn't know this. And I got a guy from a college, I offered him £25, and back then £25 was like a week's wages, you know, to come and show me what I was doing wrong, because I'd spent such a lot of time on this, and it was the easiest £25 he'd ever earned, because he was in the building in front of the machine for about 30 seconds.
Yes.
Yeah, but I willingly paid him the £25 because it's something I'd never forgotten, you know.
Makes sense. And the shape of the action came from the stock you had in your shed versus round actions, Remingtons, things like that, where yours are square.
That's right. Well, in the first place, I actually made the actions round. There are some round actions, mm-hmm. and those early actions have got CW on them, because my business partner in those days was a guy named Dave Caig, C-A-I-G. We couldn't really call it a WC action because it sort of didn't reflect very well on, you know, what our product quality was like. So we had to, you know, so we had to call it CW. Right. Then later on, the action became the CWC action because Cooper joined us. Mm-hmm. So it was Caig Walls Cooper. Then I ran out of steel, and I had an order for making a rifle quite urgently, and I thought, well, what have I got in the steel rack? And I had a bit of 1¼ by 1½ rectangular steel long enough to make an action, and all I'd do was bore a 20mm hole through it. Well, I thought initially what I'd do is I'll put the 20mm hole through it, I'll stick it between centres on the lathe, and I'll make it round, and that would get over the problem. But when I'd actually got the 20mm hole through it, I found how easy it was to machine all the different pockets in the side, like the ejector ports and all this, and the magazine port underneath and the bolt handle slot, how easy it was to make fixtures just to lay the action in and do the machining. I thought it would be foolish to actually make that round. It'd be better if I left it the shape it was. And in order to cut weight down, I just cut 45 degree corners off the top of the thing. And basically,
a profile and scallop and you're good.
Yeah, that's what I did. And it seemed to have stuck. And I've had lots of people come up with all the technical reasons as to why the action was designed that way. And, you know, they've all got the textbooks out and looked up all the scientific reasons. But the truth of the matter is the only bit of metal I had.
It was a little easier to work with because it laid flat and didn't roll away.
That's right. So that's actually the truth of the matter. But if people think I'm a clever guy, then fine. I'll let them carry on thinking it. There's no harm in that.